high desert and the great American Southwest. I bid you all good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever you may be in the world's 25 time zones. This is Midnight in the Desert. My name is Art Bell. As always, the rules are the same. No bad language and one call per show. That's it. Those are the rules. The show, however, is going to be a little different tonight. We were going to have Charles Ostman on, and I think we're going to reschedule Charles for a later date because I think we're going to do open lines. Now, I know some things. A few things. I watched the coverage of the attack all day long on CNN. And I thought from the beginning that it was terrorist. And I think a lot of the people on CNN thought so too, and then really, really played it down. I'm not sure how many of you saw the coverage, but let me read you what I have, okay, as we consider what we'll talk about tonight. There were at least two heavily armed attackers that opened fire on a banquet at a social services center for the disabled on Wednesday. Really? A social services center for the disabled? Is that a place to commit mass murder? Apparently so. 14 people are dead. Probably a dozen others seriously injured. We don't know how, we don't know how some may die. Some may recover, hopefully. It looked as though these guys were on a mission. Well, retraction. One guy, one girl, and maybe a third. Hours later, they just went in with AR-type rifles. First, they said, all earlier in the day was AK-47, right? Then later in the day, it changed into weapon. Hours later, police, hunting for the killers, riddled a black SUV. You may have seen that happen not live, actually. If cameras came on it to see the bullet holes in the body lying on the ground. With gunfire and a shootout, 2 miles from the late morning carnage, a man and woman with assault rifles, handguns, and assault-style clothing were killed. They were in the vehicle. It may well be that a third ran. They're still trying to figure that out. They don't even know if a third person had anything to do with the crime. There may only be two. Either way, CNN has not been naming anybody. I'm not going to be that careful because the Associated Press is. And so I'm not afraid to quote them. The latest on the mass shooting at a social services facility in San Bernardino, California, all times local 740 is when this ran on the Associated Press. A law enforcement official has identified Syed Farouk as one of the suspects in a mass shooting in Southern California. The official who was briefed on the case was not authorized to speak to the media about the ongoing investigation, but spoke to the AP, I guess, on condition, of course, of anonymity. Police say two suspects, a man and a woman, were killed in a gun battle. Well, I've already said this. Now, I've got some additional information that my producer quickly dug up. And this is so that I'm crediting properly here, New York Daily News exclusive, they say. Apparently, this Syed Farouk has a dad, said Syed is 30. He now knows, of course, he was linked to the slaughter that left 14 dead at the Inland Regional Center in San Bernardino. His father was shocked to learn of his son's possible involvement in the attack. He said, "I haven't heard anything," the elder Farouk told the Daily News. He was very religious. He would go to work, come home, pray, come back. He's Muslim. The shell-shocked dad said his son worked as a health technician, inspecting restaurants and hotels, graduated from La Sierra High School in 2003. After police announced the two suspects, male and female, were dead following the car chase with shootout, in a shootout, with the police, the FBI began a search of the nearby Redlands apartment linked to the younger Farouk's family. So this is a fluid, ongoing story. Very, very fluid. Changing by the minute. But clearly this is a Muslim who was involved. And so I think now you can, you know, you nobody likes to racially profile. But, you know, it looks pretty clear to me. Now, CNN was doing a good job of coverage. I've got to give them credit today. And I, you know, sort of trash them a lot on the air, but I watch them a lot. I think they're the most in middle to watch. And so I did watch their coverage, and it was credible. As far as I know, they probably still have not named one of the dead suspects. But knowing that name and knowing then his history, or a little bit of history that we could sort of scratch up on him, I think, you know, you hate to jump to conclusions, but this would appear to be a Paris-type attack, except in California, right? This time it's in California, so let's see. This would be the most dead since they killed the kids, right? Sandy Hook. And it would be the worst terrorist attack since 9/11, right? So at this hour, there's no way of knowing, you know, if what is suggested here by the man's name and the style of the attack, you know, the military garb, the high-powered ARs, the pipe bombs. They went through it pretty carefully on CNN and one person after another, except for one young lady who said she didn't care if she was wrong, said it's terrorism. International terrorism. And now it kind of looks that way. You know, we can't know until you know absolutely, but boy, it sure looks that way to me. So I guess I want to talk to you a little bit about this and see what you think. Now it's come to America. What is terrorism? Well, in this case, it was shooting a bunch of people who were just needing to do a little bit of good, right? I would say. You know, it was a center for the disabled, right? So it's not exactly, it's just simply a soft target. That's how they come for us, soft targets. And boy, baby, we're soft. I'm sorry, but it's true. I credit the police, the FBI, everybody who's down there doing their job. They are doing a great job. And two of the suspects, if it's only two, are dead. That's good. But this is terrorism now in America. This means you could walk into a supermarket. You could go to a crowded get-together, football game, whatever. And if this has now come here, and it probably has, I'm not saying definitely, but it's sure looking that way to me. I think there are a lot of things we could talk about tonight. Like what you think we ought to do, for example. So far, our role in what's going on in Syria, you know, in the middle of the caliphate, so-called, so-claimed caliphate, it's not much. I mean, we're bombing. And oh, by the way, the British just announced that as of at least tomorrow, a vote, I think it was, in parliament over there, 397 to 223, they will begin bombing in Syria as well. So now we'll have British jets over Syria, along with the French jets, the Russian jets, and the American jets. So that whole thing is going to get even more dangerous. But now we've got another problem. Now, if this is what it looks like it might be, I think it's, you know, time that we decide what we're going to do. This is now, it's about the homeland, right? It's about our homeland. So I don't think that what we're doing, we have a few special forces troops on the ground, and they spot targets and stuff like that, and maybe now a few more who will be more in a fighting mode. But our president is very, 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 very hesitant to send people on the ground in Syria, and I do get it, you know. Dangerous as hell, right? However, this is the homeland. I've sort of lived in a little personal terror for, I don't know, a while now. People doing stuff. Firing rifle rounds off. Threatening phone calls. You know, just someone out there. Outside, immediately outside my window. That's terror. So I know how it feels. And if this kind of thing continues, everybody's going to feel it. This would be a different situation. This is, well, since 9/11, which was a horrible, surreal event. But I don't know, somehow this is more personal. If that's what this is terrorism. It's way more personal. I mean, it doesn't matter. Think about it. What do? You go to football games occasionally? You get into crowds every now and then? Do you go to the grocery store? This is in San Bernardino, it just happened, right? So, again, I'm not saying absolutely what it is or isn't. I read you the name of the suspect. And every guy they had on CNN who was from the FBI, you know, usually they're retired FBI guys, right? Because the ones currently working for the FBI can't really comment. They're not allowed to, but the retired guy said, oh, boy, does this look like terrorism. When you have these kind of FBI assets deployed, this sort of number, yeah, this is probably terrorism. And now that we know the suspect's name, Syed Farouk, we know from his father that he was very religious, hadn't seen him much lately. I guess he's a recent divorced guy. But that's just a description of who probably did this, the suspect who killed these people. The reason he killed them is because of the propaganda coming out of, I should say possibly, and I mean that, coming out of Syria. The propaganda to just begin to go out and kill. Go to places and, you know, take a high-powered rifle and kill. So I thought earlier tonight, after all of this and after learning what I have now learned, that it would be kind of, I really wanted to talk to Charles Osman, but it just seemed not the right thing to do. And every now and then I do this. When something comes along like this, and I'm telling you, if it's what it is, this is really, really, really big. Because all of you out there are going to have to embrace the possibility that the war has come to our shore now. In this manifestation of just walking in and killing at random, getting as many dead as you can. I wonder what they were doing, remaining in the car, remaining close by. That's a mystery, huh? What they may have been going to do is to hit another place, you know, before they encountered the police. Well, it didn't work out, thankfully, that way for them. But that's a working theory. Nobody knows about this for sure. But I've told you to this hour what I can tell you. And now I will ask you what you think we should do. Are you satisfied with the few airstrikes we've been conducting? How many of these will have to happen before you decide that there is going to have to be massive action? They've been predicting this now for, boy, a long time. On the networks, all the talking heads have been predicting it's, we're really surprised it has not yet come to the U.S. Well, now it has. Maybe. Let me give out the numbers, and I would like to have you comment about, I don't know, what you think of this, your opinion so far. I'm sure many, if not most, watched the coverage, didn't you? And then I want to know what you'd like to do, what you think we ought to do. Here it is on our soil again, but this time, again, I say it's different. Horrible as the 9/11 disaster was, this is a different kind of terrorism. This random killing, and I guess in a sense that too was random, right? But expect it now. Grocery stores, you know, places where people meet, happened in Paris. Can sure happen here. So anyway, here come the numbers. I'm going to give you all the numbers. Anybody is welcome to call in any way they can get in. The national number is area code 952-225-5278. Once again, that's area code 952-225-5278. Are you writing that down? First-time caller line is area code 775-285-5800, 775-285-5800. You may also use the Roswell entrance point. That would be area code 575-208-7787. I've got to have Ross do more work. Again, the special event line that I'll open for all of you, 575-208-7787, Skype, of course. Here's the way it works. If you've got a smart device of some sort, doesn't matter, Apple, Android, whatever, download Skype. When you get Skype, Skype is free, right? Go to your store and get it. It's free. And then when you do, you'll learn how to add people. A little plus sign when you go in Skype, once you become familiar with it a little bit. And what's cool is this. After you've downloaded Skype, you can add us. If you're in North America, we are MITD51. It doesn't matter, uppercase, lowercase, MITD51, outside the U.S. You know, it would be very, very interesting to hear from outside the United States tonight. Come to think of it, I guess they might want to comment on this kind of terrorism now apparently or seemingly arriving here in the U.S., right here in my backyard, I might say. I mean, for me, it's just over the hill. San Bernardino is just over the hill, so it's close. Anyway, if you're elsewhere in the world and would like to comment on what has happened thus far, we are at MITD55. That's Midnight in the Desert 55. So that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to comment on the world situation, both what's gone on in San Bernardino, unfortunately, and what's going on in Syria. We'll talk about all of it.
night in the desert doesn't screen calls. We trust you, but remember, the NSA, well, you know. To call the show, please dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
Well, all right, and since this is a special night, one more time, I'm going to remind you, we have every line is full here, so still, we don't ever give these numbers. So our first-time caller line, even though I just gave it, I want to give it again, the way to get through, area code 775-285-5800, or the Roswell entry point. Area code 575-208-7787, and of course by Skype. And again, I would like to hear what people outside the country have to say. It looks as though, in my opinion, it looks as though we have just experienced our first terror attack of this kind. You know, the go in and kill as many people as you can type deal, and then get ready to give up your own life. Few things about this incident that are strange. Anyway, I'm sure you'll bring all this up. Stephen, you're on first on Skype, I think.
Hey, Art. How you doing?
I'm, well, doing all right.
Hey, I just wanted to mention, you know, a couple of the analysts on CNN said that this Saeed Farouk was at the banquet. And something happened at the banquet, and yep, he was disgruntled and left and came back.
I know.
And I just, so a bunch of them, or several of the analysts, thought that it may have been a combination of both, that something upset him, he was disgruntled, and then he was so close to jihad anyway that it just pushed him over the edge.
Not saying that isn't so. We have yet to know. All we know is, you know, the guy's name, a little bit about him. You know, apparently life was not great. He was divorced, you know, according to his dad. Very religious. And so, you're right. I mean, I watched, trust me, every minute of CNN today. I thought they did a very credible job of covering it all.
Yeah, me too. I had NBC going too, and NBC was way out front on a couple of things. But yeah, I thought they were pretty good. I did want to make one other comment. And that's the tendency to do this real macho. We should send a bunch of troops. We should. I think there's a reason why they attacked Russia, France, and the United States, and you know, they're trying to get their recruiting up. And the more it's the world against them, their recruiting goes way up.
Yeah.
And so
you've got a point.
I just think with the presidential hopefuls who are out there talking about this stuff, it's really easy to slip into that macho, you know, we should send down the thunder.
Yeah, I know. I know you're right. On the other hand, what would you have us do?
Well, I think it's a subtler deal. I think there has to be some way to compel the Arab nations, you know, the nations in the region to get more actively involved. The Jordanians have 90,000, the Turks have a million man army, Saudis have a million man army, and yet it's us, and you know they're Arabs.
Yeah.
Somehow they got to get in the game and they got to lead this. It's got to be, you know, the regular.
Okay. All right. Let me interrupt you just a little bit. I agree with you. Those countries need to be more involved in stopping ISIS. Okay, I'm with you all the way. But this is here. And once it gets here, on an increasingly frequent basis, people are not going to be patient.
Well, I agree with you. I think that's complicated, but attacking over there, that isn't going to make the people here easier to detect and prevent.
I don't have an argument for that. It's true. I mean, what you're saying is true. But can't sit on our butts either.
Well, I don't, you know, I get the feeling we work really hard. I have a funny feeling that the security services are working, you know, triple overtime trying to detect and...
No doubt about it.
I just...
The trouble is detecting and then stopping this sort of thing is damn near impossible.
Yeah. Yeah, I don't know. I just think it'll be a challenge, but... I wonder if there was some way that it could be more of a... You could communicate the message that it's not religious. It's not in their faith to do that sort of thing.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the call. I think we should communicate that to them. I don't know if it'll make a difference.
Sweet dreams are made of these. Who am I to disagree? I travel the world and the seven seas. Everybody's looking for something.
5-1 and or MITD 5-5 if you're outside of North America. And I really do want to hear from the rest of the world and what they think of the fact that apparently or seemingly or possibly, highly possibly, the same kind of terrorism that the world has been enduring, most recently in Paris, now is here. So we can talk about that. We can talk, if you wish, about Syria. Because that's where all this is coming from, right? It's being encouraged from Syria. The radical Muslims out there are getting the message out, and it's being received. Obviously, it got received in Paris, and apparently, or may have been received here. So we have this as a beginning. And what's going on in Syria? I want to talk to you about that, too, because, and again, the British are about to start bombing, because I'm telling you, World War III can start there. And, oh, by the way, the very center of ISIS's ideology is to bring about the end of the world. That's what they want, the end of the world. They want it to end. They want to be the agents that brings the end of the world. Yeah, that's really what they believe. Nobody would believe that. That's crazy, right? Guess not. So let's quickly go to John. Hello, John.
Good evening, Art. How you doing?
I'm doing okay. Can you get good and close to your mic, please?
Yeah, is that better?
A little better, yeah. Are you like on a laptop?
No. On my computer.
Oh, on your computer.
Well, on Skype and listening to you on TuneIn.
I see. All right. Well, that's the usual way, or the one way anyway. So when you talk, are you talking into like a microphone of camera?
It just comes with this cheap little camera that sits on top of the computer.
All right. Now
probably not the best.
Okay, we're going to try an experiment. Can you just pick that up, you know, that camera, and talk into it? All right, now talk into it.
Is that any better?
Oh, yeah, baby. And see, I do that on the air so that everybody can hear how much better it is, and then they do it. So go ahead.
All righty. Well, I'll tell you, I live here in Palm, and...
Really?
I find myself getting a little callous to these killings. You had Sandy Hook. You got all these crazy things going on with all these assault rifles and...
Yep.
And I don't understand why that we can have people that are on a no-fly list still be able to walk into a gun show and buy an assault rifle.
You listen to the president, huh?
Well, yeah.
Yeah, he's absolutely right about that, of course. If you're on a no-fly list, then hell no, you shouldn't be able to buy a gun.
Well, I was talking with some friends today, earlier when we just heard about this thing starting up in San Bernardino, and... We got to talking about guns, and, you know, you go to some of the political meetings here in this town, sure you've attended and stuff.
Listen, people have no idea. This is still the Wild West out here, isn't it, sir?
Oh, yes. It's kind of crazy. And you know, I can understand the people, they're really far out right wing, you know, being concerned about their guns, but...
There's guns everywhere here.
I don't think we need assault rifles, you know.
Well, I don't know. I mean, if the guy trying to get you has an assault rifle, probably...
Well, that's the thing, you know. I hear the Republicans, like, talking about, you know, well, if everybody had a gun, you know, this wouldn't happen. I don't know. I just kind of wonder... What kind of society do they want to build?
Well, there aren't many people who carry guns in San Bernardino, I'll tell you that. Here in Pahrump, Nevada, you know, there's a joke going around. Somebody will walk into Walmart and some recent person who moved here from, I don't know, California, for example, will go into Walmart and they'll see some guy wearing a gun and they call the sheriff. Oh, my God, oh, my God, this guy wearing a gun. Well, is he shooting people? No.
Yeah. Well, I know I moved here from Iowa, and it kind of upset me the first time I started looking around, seeing guns in restaurants and stores.
I don't think they're the problem. People wanting to use them to murder, that's a big, big problem. You suddenly disappeared, kind of. I'm sorry, your audio just sounded bad. I don't know what happened. I'm going to guess you might have pulled the wire, so I'm sorry if I had you do that. Truly, I am. Let's go to the phone and say, Missoula, Montana, you are on the air. Hello.
Yes, hello, sir.
Hi.
Hi. Thank you for taking my call.
You're welcome.
Thank you. It's kind of interesting that I should follow that gentleman who you just spoke to. I think in light of recent events, I would strongly advocate for firearms training for American citizens who are able and basically able to defend themselves.
They may need it.
I would concur.
There's going to be two gigantic groups of people calling tonight if it's going to get to be about guns, and that's going to be the people who believe absolutely in the right and the people who think all guns should be taken away. And I'm not sure I want to exactly have that fight tonight. I'm pro-gun. I own guns. I wouldn't be without guns.
Sir. I don't want to get into that fight as well. In fact, I don't want to go there at all. It's just, it seems to me that with the recent events that have occurred in the world, these incidents have occurred in areas where they are gun-free zones. And I'm sorry to say that. I know that might offend a lot of people.
But it's true.
The facts are as they are.
It's true.
I work with two Marines who actually strongly advocate that young men, unfortunately, do not join the service at this very moment due to the fact that their services may be needed here in the United States to defend the homeland rather than go overseas and fight. And I think that's it's a terrible way of looking at the world, but unfortunately, I am personally sick and tired of these cowardly acts and what is going on in the world. And I, for one, would strongly advocate that citizens who, you know, want to be in a world where they don't have to worry about walking in the street would take care of themselves in a responsible fashion.
All right, sir. Thank you very much for the call. I am pro-gun. All right? In other words, I think if you... Look, it's the Second Amendment. It's your right to have a gun, carry a gun. If you pass, you know, for example, I have a carry permit. My wife has a carry permit. I went to school. Actually, I've been to school many times. And you find out, you know, when it's legal to shoot, when it's not legal to shoot. You find out how to safely use the weapon. You find out how to efficiently use the weapon, you know, you have to fire. So you have to go through some preparation to get a carry permit. And I don't want to get into that argument tonight about guns one way or the other. I simply believe that we should be allowed to have weapons, if we can demonstrate that we are responsible. The guy who called up and repeated what the president said is right. You know, if you are on a no-fly list, well, probably you shouldn't be, you know, able to buy a gun. That's reasonable. But it's the small picture. The big picture is, what are we going to do about this? It's here now. I think, in spades. Maybe I'm wrong, and I hope that I'm proven to be wrong. But I'd be just willing to bet you this is international terrorism on our porch. Hello there, Paul. You're on the air.
Hello, Art.
Hello, sir.
How are you?
I'm fine.
Okay. I believe you spent time in the Philippines and would be familiar with a martial art called Kempo.
I am familiar with it, yes.
All right. I've had a lifetime familiarity with it, and it is a universal martial art where we do a lot of strategic thinking. And
okay, give me some strategic thinking about this situation, whether it's what just happened or Syria, you know, the caliphate.
I think in both cases we need to respond surely with extreme prejudice. We need to go in and we need to attack them with the same ferocity that they have demonstrated here. And I believe here...
Well, what they're demonstrating here is random killing. Now, surely you are not suggesting that we go and randomly kill Syrians.
No. I would only say, and I don't want to get into this gun thing either, because I, as you know, I'm in Kentucky, and that speaks for itself.
Pretty much.
I do want to say that Admiral Yamamoto discouraged the Japanese in World War II from invading the West Coast by simply stating, as he was educated here, it is a fight we can never win. They will fight from every hill, from every tree, from every street, from every window, because he well knew that we were an armed society.
Mm-hmm.
And I also, because of your time in Asia, would, and it's redundant to even say this to you, it's embarrassing, but I'm saying it to everyone out there, the most polite society known to history was the samurai-driven society, because sword fights don't involve prolonged television-type exchanges, nor do knife fights. Generally, three moves, someone's down. Four moves at the most. This also has to do with hand-to-hand combat.
And so you apply this to this situation how?
I believe the more sane citizens that are armed are the biggest deterrent we can have. We simply
don't ignore the
police.
All right, that's the argument all over again, and I'll take it and not say you're wrong. I'll not say you're wrong. Look what's going on in Chicago. Chicago is a you-really-can't-get-a-gun-permit kind of place, right? Just like San Bernardino. Pretty much same way, right? You want a permit to carry in San Bernardino, you better be, I don't know, a celebrity or have a lot of money or really have a serious reason to want to carry a gun. Look what's going on in Chicago again. Number of, it's just, it's crazy. So I understand the argument, folks. Bend, Oregon. You're on the air.
Hello?
Hi.
Hi, Art. Art, this is a terrible day.
Yeah, it is.
It's a terrible day. I'm just praying for those people who lost their lives today. Well, I'm glad I live in the desert because I live actually in a smaller town in Bend up the road, Redmond. And something like that can't happen here because we haven't been...
I'm sorry, I shouldn't laugh. Of course it can happen there.
Yeah, but not for long.
And again, you're going to make the same argument, right? Because everybody up there is toting a weapon.
But I'm going to take it a step further and say we really need to sort of export this out to the country.
I'm not... Look, okay, sir, just pause for one moment, please, everybody. Hold on, sir. Hold on. Accept the fact that I agree with you that people who can demonstrate sanity and accuracy should be allowed to carry guns. I don't need that argument. And I agree with you. If, you know, it may well be that if people down there had been armed, they would have been taken out more quickly. I don't know. So I accept that argument. So let's not argue the gun thing, okay?
Okay. Well, then I'll just say I think these soft targets need to be hardened, and we need to do it on a national level.
Well, there's a job for you.
Well, it's just going to have to happen because this is just going to continue to happen, and I think it needs to be nipped in the bud. Just get the army out there and be there for a while.
You want the army on the streets?
Well, I don't know. National Guard, maybe.
Yeah.
Or the police. Believe me, when I was at Ground Zero on 9/11. I was up the West Side Highway a little bit over by the Intrepid and headed down there when it all happened. I saw it all happen. And when that was happening, there were planes everywhere flying over the city, flying over New Jersey, along New Jersey. And I was praying for an F-16 to come, you know. And that's how people have to think. Like, they just have to think, this person with this AR-15 is necessary here. Because certainly, if anything ever happens, they're going to be glad they're there.
Well, that's true. I, you know, do you have any thoughts on, other than, you know, you mentioned military or streets, a lot of people would object to that. In fact, once you start talking about that, there are going to be a lot of people that say, well, look at that, a false flag type deal done so that we can put military on the streets and control every movement of the American people. I guarantee you there are people dialing to say that right now.
I understand that. I mean, I follow, like, some of the conspiracy theories out there and false flag ideas. You know, I did a little studying on 9/11 because I was so close to it. But really, you can see a false flag in anything. And
yeah,
really,
that's right, you can. And they also think that Sandy Hook was false flag. I get that all the time.
Yeah, yeah. But the thing is, the people getting killed are real.
Oh, yeah?
And the forces out there that can stop this sort of thing are there, too. It's just that they're not. We're not seeing it realistically right now. We're not. We're still kind of like in a bubble here, in kind of a PC bubble, and it's crashing down around us, you know. So at some point, we're going to have to get real.
Well, the bubble's about to break. I'm telling you, if this is our future, the American people will demand that a lot of things happen very quickly. And, boy, I'll tell you, brother, what's going on in Syria right now is so dangerous. And I don't mean... well, I do mean for every single soul that I'm speaking to right now, it could be World War III. And remember, those guys in black, sir, that's what they want, is World War III. The end of it.
Well, I heard your show on global thermonuclear war, and
yeah.
I really have to have confidence that nobody's crazy enough to do that.
But they are.
I really do.
Yeah, but, sir, they are. That's what you're not getting. They definitely are that crazy. That is the center of what they believe. They want to bring about the end of the world.
I understand that, yeah. Well, I heard a great interview the other day. It was this person on the street he interviewed, and they asked what the solution would be. And he said, let's just go over there and make it so the Syrians can go home.
And on that note, I've got to go, not home, but to a break. Okay, so... I'm sorry, I've been several people calling internationally, and I haven't gotten to you yet. Please call again. In fact, it's going totally berserk on Skype. So if you want to get in, I'll give you the numbers. I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert.
Midnight in the Desert. To call the show, if you're east of midnight, call 1-952-CALL-ART. If you're west of midnight, call 1-952-225-5278.
Well, all right. Top of the hour, and let me tell you all, those of you I know some join at this hour, I observe the CNN coverage of what's occurred in Southern California today, beginning to end. About 20 minutes ahead of airtime, the Associated Press ran a story with the name of one of the, or the dead man. It's Syed Farouk. Now, his dad has commented to a New York source that he is was a very religious man. Prays a whole lot. Goes to mosque a lot. He is, according to the article we read from New York, a divorced fellow. Probably not in a great frame of mind. And his dad is shocked, of course, as most dads are when they find out somebody had something to do, you know, did something like this. They just go, oh, my God, it can't be. Bottom line here is that, you know, terrorism has arrived. The personal, mindless kind of go into a grocery store or crowded arena and commit mayhem kind of terrorism is right here. So what do we, you know, I've canceled my guest. I'm sorry, it wouldn't be, Charles Osman was going to be here on, and we're going to get him here. I promise you we're going to reschedule Charles, but this is so important. Charles was going to talk about AI, artificial intelligence, and I'm asking you what you think we ought to do. And I'm getting some pretty surprising answers, I would say. So overseas, Joe, you're on the air.
Hello.
Yeah, hi, Joe. Where are you?
I'm in China.
China? Wow.
Yeah, I'm in Shenzhen, China. Can you hear me well?
Yes, that's the factory town, right?
Yes, it is. Yes, I'm here. I'm listening to you all the time. I'm so glad you're back in on the air. You're a great man.
Thank you.
I want to tell you a little story that I had. A couple of years ago, I was coming back from Poland, and I was sitting next to a man, and he was well dressed, and he wanted to buy me a drink. Well, I know that they usually don't have a lot of money, and then he started to talk. He says, I'm a lawyer, and I'm from Russia. And he said, I wish that we would have guns. Otherwise, these people would have never done this to us. And he was talking about the Communist Party. I was really shocked when he said that to me.
Man.
But I just wanted to...
Man, every single call I've had so far has been, we need guns. I agree. We need guns.
Yeah, it happened in Croatia, too. Yeah. Russia didn't attack them because everybody had a gun underneath their bed. And Tito said, okay, you want to come? He said, I've got 8 million men that'll hit the streets. And they didn't attack and take Yugoslavia, Croatia at that time.
Well, so, you know where you live. Yeah, you know where you live. You can't have a gun.
Oh, no, not here. But they have. The real, real bad people have guns. And
they always do.
Yes, they do. And they'll kill you, you know. But the police are afraid to go where they're at. There's a little, like, even in a big city like this, they call it a village. And they will attack the police. So, but they deal with them swiftly. You know, they put a bullet in their head. So I'm careful here. I teach English. I'm your age, Art. I haven't given up. I haven't died yet. So I'm still working, and I think it's a...
Every day you wake up, new surprise.
Yeah, essence of life. But I just... I want everybody to cheer up a little bit. Life isn't easy, and we have a great country.
May I ask you a question?
Yes.
Are you getting good news there in China?
Well, I would like to tell everyone that they love Obama. They love
Chinese.
The
Chinese love Obama. Okay.
Oh, of course, because he's weak. But they really like Putin.
And, I don't want to get you in any trouble, but I mean, when I say are you getting good news there? I doubt you get CNN, for example, right?
Yes, I can listen to CNN anything. I got VPN, and that's how I can get out and watch football games and all of that stuff. Yes.
Oh, now wait a minute. They don't let football in.
Well, they do, but it's a lot easier to get this in there. But they won't let a conservative station in. Fox is banned here.
Really?
CNN isn't, but Fox is banned. You know, they're conservative. Like, the University of Chicago is very liberal, and they love the University of Chicago.
So Fox is banned in China. CNN isn't.
Right.
Incredible. Incredible. All right. So are you if you've got CNN, then you're getting the news and you know everything that's happened here, right?
Yes, I know everything's happening. My heart goes out to those people that got killed. I fought in Vietnam and I understand violence, and I still believe we should have a right to bear arms. It's really important for us. So our government can't take us. I'm not a paranoid human being, but you never know what can happen.
Listen, I'm with you all the way, and that seems to be the argument that everybody wants to make. So,
and everyone should have a brave heart. We have to be tough, we have to be strong, and we have to go forward. We can't go backwards. We can't be feel sorry for everybody and bullies. And my God, I don't know what's happening with our country. They don't have bullies here. They don't care about that stuff.
Well, they probably shoot the bullies there.
Yeah, lawyers, you go to the zoo here and fall in a pit with a lion. And
They shoot lawyers there?
Oh, yeah, they have lawyers.
No, I mean, I said they shoot lawyers?
No.
That's what I thought you said.
No, they don't shoot lawyers. At least I don't think so. But they don't sue everybody here. You know, everybody's responsible for themselves. There's no socialism here. It is all their capitalists, and they're growing.
Well, it's pretty much pure communism, actually, right?
Well, no.
Or modified. It's modified communism.
Yes, capitalism in exhilarating. If you came here, you would see all our buildings here.
I've been there.
Yes, yeah, it's amazing.
There. How's the traffic, by the way?
It's awful, but I'm right outside of Hong Kong. Hong Kong is really... blazingly or terrifically crowded.
Yes.
But it's different.
So hearing about this horrible thing that's happened in San Bernardino does not surprise you.
No, it doesn't. I mean, we have to be vigilant. We have to all be vigilant, not just sit there and take it like sheep. We have to be vigilant. We have to be aware, and we have to be protective of all our people. So I think we'll win in the end. I really have a lot of faith in our sense of waking us up, just like the Japanese did in Pearl Harbor. I just think that we'll come out of this, but we will lose some people, I think.
All right. I appreciate your call all the way from China, mainland China. See, that's what's really cool about this setup we've got. People can communicate to us from anywhere in the world. And so you don't just get the U.S. sort of take on it. You get the world's take on it. So if you're out in the world there, you want to call us. We are MITD55 on Skype. That's MITD55. Calls are just slamming in. Actually, can't get a clear line. So let me try. Let me try this. Somewhere in Wisconsin, I'm thinking. You're on air.
Well, hello. Is this Richard? I mean, is this Bell? Thanks. I think you're talking to me, right?
Well, I don't know. Richard's not here.
Oh, yeah, Richard. Good. Mr. Bell, that's really honor to talk to you. I just wanted to make a comment about the founding fathers. You know, they were single-shot pistols and muzzle loaders. They weren't these automatic weapons.
Yeah.
So, okay, so I'll just... I mean, I think we should get back to, culture and the arts and, not this mentality of, the hero.
Yeah, you're a little hard. You don't have a real good connection, sir. Either that or you're overly excited. I can't tell which.
Well, I guess it's that. I've never talked on the radio before.
Okay.
But, the hero warrior... mentality. Right makes right, and that everything could be solved with a gun instead of in Tibet. They thought that 6,000 monasteries.
All right, sir. Hold on for a second. I want to ask you a question because I can see where you're headed, okay?
Yes.
If you were in charge, and you're going to have to make this fast because you don't have a good connection. But if you were in charge, sir, and you could be a dictator and say, here's what's going to happen. Yeah, we're facing these people now who are going to come in and, kill us in crowds and that sort of thing. What do we do? You're in charge. What would you do, sir?
Well, I guarantee you, if all these hundreds of millions of guns that were in the country were banned, that this would have never happened.
Okay, all right. Thank you very much for the call. And so there you go. Finally got the other side of it. Do you really think that's true? Are we going to end up in a gun rights argument tonight? Is that how this is going to go? He's obviously in favor of having all the guns taken. Said if they were all taken, boy, this wouldn't happen. Counter-argument, of course, lots of gun-free zones, right, where you can't carry a gun, can't own a gun even. A few places where you can't even own a gun. But wait, that's where all the crime keeps happening. But we're not talking about crime right now. We're talking about mass terrorism, right? Roxanne, you're on the air. Oh, now you're on the air. Sorry.
Definitely a sad day, my dear. But, Syria has a really big problem with refugees, and I really feel for them, too, as well as terrorists that are killing the people here in America. But I'm thinking, let's just get the president out of there. He's not wanted by anyone, really. He's not doing the Syrians any good. He ought to step down. They ought to get and relieve all those Syrians, get the ones that want out of there out. And let's just surround the country and just do like you do with a game of Risk,
Well, wait a minute. Wait, stop. You said the president has to go.
Yeah.
Which president are you talking about?
In Syria.
Bashar al-Assad.
Yes.
Yeah. Well, you agree then. You agree with the U.S.
No,
who wants...
I don't.
Yeah, it's so mixed up. I'm sorry. I'm wrong. It's us. We want him out. The problem, the only problem with that is, okay, I want you to address something for me if you really feel that way. If we get rid of Assad, I think it's probably doable. We could do it. Mm-hmm. But shouldn't we first look next door to Iraq? Because we got rid of that guy, right? And how did that turn out for us?
Yes, but we didn't have Russia and China on the back door, did we? We didn't have World War III ready to start, did we? I live next to the missile silos. If I see one of them boogers come up, I know it's the end, So I'm not scared, but I'm seeing a lot of people on the Internet talking about guns, talking about false flags.
Yeah, I know.
I'm tired.
I know. I'm tired of it, too.
BS.
I'm tired
But, I'm trying to get real here. Let's just clean it up. get everything out of there, ISIS, everybody. Clean the borders up on Iraq, and let's get Iran on a good note, and let's say, hey, you know, I know the people in Iran. They're really nice people. It's the government that's doing their game or whatever with whoever, and they have their fingers in every pot, and they want this big pipeline of oil to go through Syria. Remember that?
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. And so now everybody's saying, oh, well, that's why we're there, you know. Well, we've got hundreds of thousands of refugees that have left everything they know. And we're not talking about just poor people. We're talking about people that own land. We're talking about people who love their land, who've been there for generations. This hurts, you know, them.
So
let's get rid of the bad boys, okay?
Yeah.
And let's surround it with love. I don't know any other way.
Well, everybody else has been talking about guns.
I know, and I knew you opened that can of worms. I knew that was going
to
happen.
I didn't mean to do that. I mean, these people are calling on their own. All I said was, what do we do about it? And the answer for everybody is, get your gun.
Well, you know, get your gun, but use your brain. Guns don't kill people. People kill people.
Right. But that's a little overused,
I guess. China. He was wonderful tonight. He made us laugh. That was the first laugh I had all day.
He did. And he's a pretty brave soul, too, because they don't like you anyway.
No.
He's brave.
But anyway, I want to shout out to Art Bell Time Travelers Group on Facebook, and also for people to get into Art Bell's .com to buy the archives. They're
all
worth
right.
every penny.
Thank you. That's very sweet of you to say, and I agree with you. The archives are very worthy indeed. You can listen anytime you want to. And, of course, you can use the wormhole, which I guess I should be paying attention to, right? So let me take a look. Of course, Art, you're going to have just gun debate callers. People have lost the ability to think outside the talking points of the fascist talking heads on both sides. Ooh. The gun argument that everybody should have a gun. Listen to me. I agree with you. Let's not prolong the agony of this. I agree. If there were more guns by people who were sane, who were willing to carry one, because let me tell you something, it's not actually that much fun to have to carry a gun. It's quite a pain in the butt, quite literally. Any cop will tell you after the, I suppose, thrill of being able to carry a gun when they first become a cop, it quickly gets very, very old. I don't like carrying a gun. I'm authorized to do so, but I don't like it. On all kinds of levels, I don't like it. So I'm not going to argue with you about guns. Yes, of course it would help if more people had guns, knew how to use them properly. And then maybe fewer would die in these mass incidents. The big question is, what we're going to do about these mass things that keep occurring? This, I believe, is the beginning. By the way, one of you out there might update me. Have they yet, on CNN, decided to call it terrorism? Suspected international terrorism? I had to leave coverage about, 2 hours ago? Even though I've got up-to-date and up-to-minute information, I don't know what they're saying. Okay, let's go to Dutch. Hello, Dutch, you're on the air.
Hey, Art, it's great to finally talk to you. I have been listening since Charlie was a regular.
Oh, my God.
hey, I think you're right. I don't want this to turn into a gun debate. I think people need to think a little bit larger. It's a war. It finally happened on sacred, precious American soil. But the battlefield it's here. It's San Bernardino.
Yeah.
And that's the mindset. We have to realize the war has come to America.
Yes. Well, let's just assume that most people, rational people, and I shouldn't assume this, but most of them are going to think that people having guns who you know how to use them might save some lives. But the bigger question is how we're going to address this, what we're going to do in Syria. And that's where it's got to be addressed. It will continue here, but the genesis of this is without question in Syria.
Absolutely.
The genesis is in what they believe, ISIS believes, and they want the end of the world. And they want us on the ground. They want our troops to fight. I know they want all that. Should we give it to them in spades or not?
Let's take a step back. Well, yes and no, but let's take a step back, right? And okay. I don't want to get political either, but...
No, go ahead. Whatever.
Okay, the Obama administration, their narrative on Benghazi, right?
Yes.
Was, we all know that it was a lie, right? Writes that on the television on Sunday and told a lie and sold us that narrative. And it's not true. So here's the thing. What right-minded thinking person on the planet is going to believe the narrative coming out of the administration right now? So we can't even trust the information coming from the national leadership. What we heard about Libya was...
Well, let's you and I go back to Benghazi for just a moment. Okay, you said it was a lie, and kind of, it was a lie. It was a spin, and I think you're right to say it was a lie. And so we know our government does lie to us, right?
Right. I guess we have that disingenuous instead of lie.
We have that. We have that as a base that they spin things the way they want them spun.
Yeah. True. So how can we trust them with Libya, with Syria? How can we trust the narrative? So sending troops in under lies, disingenuousness, and false narratives, we're never going to get the people behind the real problems in the Middle East as long as it's knee-jerk reaction to the battlefield in San Bernardino or the battlefield in... wherever it is, as it continues to happen in the United States. So the knee-jerk stuff is going to get us in trouble. It's not strategic thinking. It's not tactical thinking, right? It's knee-jerk stuff.
All right, so give me,
never been good at
give
that.
Me some strategic tactical thinking.
All right, so if let's say that you looked at rather a military decision versus a political decision. The strategic agility in the military mind would suggest that the no-fly zones work. They also, one area Obama's probably right. You want to avoid World War III at all costs.
I'll go for that.
So, you know, how do we avoid Chamberlain's mistake in appeasement? You know, how do we do that, right? So what we do is we leverage our technology. We leverage our technology in the Middle East and with the Russians, and we create no-fly zones. And when we draw a red line, we stick to that red line. So maybe right now, Assad is the lesser of two evils. And so how do you prop up that government, make it safer, do no-fly zones, and make this a real military issue, whether it's on the borders of Turkey, Syria, or Iraq? You know, that's
right.
The thing.
All
so
right. Let's
the next
talk.
Level of
can
strategic
can we, hold
thinking
it,
is, right?
Hold it.
If you,
stop,
if ISIS,
stop.
Right.
Let's talk about no-fly zones for a second, because you said we should have a no-fly zone, right?
Correct.
Okay, so let's say we announce no-fly zone and the Russians fly. What would you do?
Right. So, again, you know, we come back to Chamberlain's problem. How do we...
No, you're the president, okay, and we have a no-fly zone because you decreed it so. Now, the Russians just violated the no-fly zone. What do you do, Mr. President?
Well, if there are American lives at danger, all right, if there's a real situation where American lives are at danger, you react one way. But if you take a look at the missile Cuban crisis, our planes took damage, our planes took bullets from the Cubans, but the pilots were ordered to not get shot. And by being ordered not to get shot, in essence, they didn't report being shot, then they prevented a huge crisis in Cuba back in the 60s, obviously.
All right, and so then how would you move that thinking into a situation, Mr. President, where your no-fly zone has just been violated, Russia's flying jets like crazy, like they are right now, so what do we do?
Right, so if American interests and lives aren't at danger and you break the no-fly zone, then you don't react militarily. Something happens behind doors, a conversation, you pick up the phone,
well, that's,
something along those lines.
Okay, that's not a no-fly zone.
Okay, so...
In other words, you're saying if they fly, then you ignore it.
Well, okay, so it's not that you ignore it. Again, we come back to Chamberlain, right? Do you appease an instant? Do you appease a tiny, itty-bitty, isolated incident? Or do you appease a policy that's protracted and can lead to dangerous places?
Mr. President, don't draw lines that you're not going to react to if they're crossed.
Well, the first time, you know, American interests are attacked,
yes,
whether it's Russian or Chinese,
yes,
or Iraq or Iran, then, yeah, we have to react. But if there's no danger, then if it's an error, or it's even if it's just a snub nose, sometimes you have to turn the other cheek and let
turn
the diplomacy work behind the scenes.
All right, sir, I appreciate your call. And I can see that turned cheek. Yes, sirree, sir. There'll be some reaction to that. Guaranteed. Hi, you're on the air.
Hello, Art. How are you doing tonight?
Well, you're listening, right? You can
tell. It's kind of a sad evening tonight.
It is.
I mean, I've gone through enough with 9/11. I mean, I was, again, an NYPD veteran for 25 years. My name is John from New York.
John, I hear the New York in you.
Yeah, I have the slight twang of an accent, so to speak. But, I went through a lot with 9/11. I worked with the FBI Anti-Terrorist Task Force. I retired from PD. I still work in law enforcement in the city, though, within the city.
Mm-hmm.
So I work in Lower Manhattan. So there's always a threat down there of something going on. And I noticed a lot during 9/11 that working with the FBI closely with them and seeing what their mentality was, there was a problem in New York. The people couldn't handle the security that was involved in trying to stop stuff like this from happening.
Right.
The tension level was through the roof at that time. I would come in, and you're probably familiar with Manhattan. Have you been here before?
Absolutely, yes.
Okay. So I used to drive down in the patrol car, and we'd hit the 70s. This is like the day after 9/11, September 12th. So we drive down through 72nd Street. Everything above 72nd Street was one big party. You had people in all the bars and the clubs. It was their way of venting. They were smoking, drinking,
sure,
acting like nothing happened.
Sure.
You got past 72nd Street, and the city was a ghost town. It was like a morgue all the way down to Ground Zero, because I spent 4 months down there working with this mess. And you could see that the tension level was so high. I mean, I saw a side of New York I never expected to see. You had people that were extra nice. They would cry, come up to you, and just hug you and thank you for helping. They'd fight over who's going to buy you a cup of coffee in the morning.
Right.
The problem you had is that shortly after 9/11, the tension level was so high, they had no way to relieve it. Even the psychologists within the city were comforting each other because they didn't know how to handle it. Went back to their old ways of doing things. They started to act like nothing happened. See, what you need to do in a country like this, you have to look at, and I use an example of Israel because they're a pretty good example of continuous terrorism.
They are. Yes, they are.
Yeah, the prime example. And their security methods, to me, are some of the best you're going to get in the world.
They are?
Because they're able. If you notice, and I hate to say it this way, but they don't smile that much when you see them. They're very serious people, a very serious group.
I found Israel to be an interesting place. Boy, you walk down the street and you see young kids with automatic weapons slung over their shoulder. You know, it's just like part of everyday life.
Well, exactly. That's what you're getting there. And if you listen to them when they had the latest group of attacks happening at the bus stops,
mm-hmm,
they were encouraging their citizens to carry their weapons. Anybody that has a weapon, we want you to carry it.
I know.
Please.
Hey, listen, I'm coming up on a break. Can you hold on?
Sure, definitely.
All right, I'm coming back to you in New York. Ex-New York PD. knows what he's talking about. This is Midnight in the Desert, and we will be back.
Midnight in the Desert doesn't screen calls. We trust you, but remember, the NSA... Well, you know. To call the show, please dial 1-952-225-5278. That's 1-952-CALL-ART.
That's hilarious. There was a little breakup in that. And actually, the way it was this time, when he mentioned NSA, it was like on the phone. Sorry, finding a little humor in an otherwise horrible day. Horrible. We're talking about what happened in San Bernardino today. I followed every minute of it. And I've got a, I guess now retired cop in New York. Is that right? Retired, right?
Yes, retired, but still active in law enforcement. I have another job with the city in law enforcement.
You never really give it up, right?
No, once it's in your blood, if you enjoy what you do, and you to me, I like helping people. So, I mean, I have a master's in psychology and just about finishing up a PhD in clinical psych. So,
all right. Well, like so we have, I'd love your comments. I mean, I think this may be the beginning of these kinds of attacks, you know, on just crowds and just shooting a bunch of people, as many as you can. That's what we're facing, probably influenced from Syria or maybe influenced from Syria. It sure looks that way. Anyway, would you say if you could mandate what would be done, you would do?
Well, the first thing I would do is I would have to get the people of this country used to very heavy increases in security, which, again, the tolerance level in this country in general, I mean, it's a free country. Nobody likes military-style tactics. Nobody likes having to go through metal detectors all the time. But if you start looking at the type of attacks that are going to be happening, I've been saying it since 9/11, and the FBI task force I worked with at the time said, it's going to happen again, it's going to happen here, it's just a matter of time and when it's going to happen. And this was back then. And again, they, you know, New York City, NYPD is very good at breaking stuff up before it happens. But it's still eventually going to happen. So me, I would start implementing where you're going to have security, armed security, at loads of places. You're going to have to have armed security at schools. Any place where there's large gatherings of people, you're going to need metal detectors. The other thing is, I mean, what do you do with the subway system? Well, you could have metal detectors at the subway entrances because all you need to do is hit a couple of subways, a couple of bridges, and a couple of locations at the same time like they did in Paris and California type of thing. It'll bring the city to a standstill. As it is with the traffic jams in these big cities, they have enough trouble getting around. Picture an attack like that, eliminating a tunnel or a bridge or something. That's all you need. So they'd have to increase heavy security in that sense, metal detectors. The stop and frisk laws that the mayor of the city just stopped, which I don't agree with that, you have to start increasing it because since he stopped it, the crime rate in the city has gone through the roof. And if you have a suspicion that somebody may be carrying something, there are many mornings, because I get up at 5 a.m., so I'm out early with the crowds. There are many mornings where I'll go to work and I'll see something because I take buses and trains to get to work in Lower Manhattan if I'm not doing field work. So I'll see something on the subway. I mean, one day I had I saw boxes of metal stuff underneath the benches they have in the subway system. Other people just walk by it like nothing's going on. I'll stop. I'll call it in. I'll let the motorman know. I'll say, look, get PD down here. I'll call 911 myself, have them come down and shut the station down and let the bomb squad come in. This is stuff where people are not used to doing. I mean, they're not aware of their surroundings. They don't pay close enough attention to it. That's part of the problem you have. And people don't like to live like that. And I understand it. It's a factor of life that, I mean, it's changed a lot since when I was a kid growing up in the 60s and 70s, you know, 70s pretty much. You know, I was a kid growing up, things were different back then. You know, you had your little things going on, but not to this extent.
No.
Now, what's changed that brought all this on? That's another thing you have to look at.
And I want to look at that. I mean, you're right. So you're saying, look, get ready for it. Life is going to change in ways you may not like. It's going to have to.
It is. There's no way around it. And until you get yourself prepared for that mental state, like I said, I saw it with 9/11 big time, and I saw how they returned to, like they had security in the tunnels, the Holland Tunnel, Lincoln Tunnel. You had security where if you were PD or anybody with federal, you'd identify yourself and they'd let you go through the tunnels because the tunnels were off limits to anybody but emergency personnel.
Sure, and I know they're prime targets. Look, we don't have a lot of time, but I do want to ask you about this. What would you think we should do in Syria? God, it's so dangerous over there. It's getting worse by the minute. And that's, frankly, where all this is coming from. This caliphate is where all this stuff is coming from.
Well, it's coming from Syria, but understand that prior to Syria, you had other countries that can't stand America.
Oh, sure.
And our beliefs and everything else. So you already have tons of terrorists that are pocketed in this country that people don't know about.
Mm-hmm.
They're homegrown. They're in the country. They have American passports. Now, you could go in and eliminate Syria. You could go in and take Bashar out and do what you have to do with this. But the problem you're going to have is Russia. Russia, you don't want to start World War III. That's another disaster you want to try to avoid. So it's a chess game out there. It's a chess game in Syria because of the position that Russia's taken on things, China's taken on things. What do you actually do? Do you send the troops in? That might be an alternative to eliminate the Syrian problem. But you're still going to have all these people in this country that are already here.
I think originally we were all in favor of taking out Assad. But, you know, I wonder if we thought it through, because we took out the leader there in Iraq, and that just
and
didn't work out.
Yeah, that backfired. It wasn't a good thing.
So
you have to come to an agreement. They really should sit down with Putin, talk things out. But you have to look at, okay, is taking out the Syrian threat going to eliminate the threat to this country and the rest of the world?
No.
You have to wait. That's the factor you really need to take a closer look at. What could be done to protect American lives, to protect French lives? You know, you want to protect your citizens of your country. Now, do you close all immigration for a time? Because I'll be honest with you, there's really no way to completely vet a citizen from another country
if
you don't have any records on them. There's no way to safely do it. I don't care how many people from the NSA or the CIA and everybody else you have investigating them. Because now they're saying, well, we're going to do 3 years of vetting to get them in. It doesn't work that way. If you don't know their background, you're taking their word for stuff. So is that an answer to it? It's a tough spot.
Yep.
It's a really tough spot. And the only thing I could see logically to do, seriously, is prepare the people in this country. Now, in the meantime, if you get Assad out and do what you have to do there, all right, that may knock some of it down. But you still have to worry about the fanatics that are already here. Because in my view, there's a fine line between religion and fanaticism.
Boy, is there.
There's a very fine line. And believe me when I tell you, you could tell right away who's going to cross that line. It's a gut feeling after all the years of doing what I've done. But if you watch closely, you'll see who gets angry with religion. Religion's supposed to be a peaceful thing. It's not supposed to be a violent thing. The ones that get angry and have such hostility that they want to hurt people, those are the ones you have to look at.
Well, they want the end of the world.
Yeah, they want the end of the world because they're going to get their seven virgins and be in paradise and everything else. And they have a view of life that is totally different from the majority. Now, what's the right view? You know, everybody could say, oh, it's my view is right. Their view is right. It's not even that. It's a matter of who's going to act on their view and take action to stop what's going on. But if this country would wake up more and get the security going, and if they could handle it, they really need to be able to handle an increased security level. Because I know New Yorkers in general, we're very resilient people in this city, but they walked around. When I was working with the FBI group, the terrorist task force, they said to me, John, you know, I got to tell you, they said in the last week, the security level in the tunnels have dropped. That was the point I was trying to bring out, that there was a while where all you had to do was hold up a badge. They weren't stopping you, weren't checking your ID cards. This was in the week after the attacks.
Mm-hmm.
They were letting anybody that held something up go through without checking them. And they said, this is not the way to be. And I I agreed with him 100%. He said, you know, this is why New York, you can't, people in general, not just New Yorkers, in general, do you think people in where you're located, in Nevada, do you think they could handle increased security? Could they handle metal detectors? Would they like to see that?
I think they could handle metal detectors, but if it gets to the degree that it is in Israel, not so much.
Exactly. And like I say, I use New York as the example because that 72nd Street was the benchmark for me. When I saw them relieving stress by drinking and smoking and increasing their partying and then going to a ghost town down below, you could see the tension levels were through the roof.
Look, you're a caller. I know you're one of the best callers I've ever had, but I'm going to have to go become a regular caller. Right.
I called last night for the first time in a while, so I'm glad you're back on the air. I spoke to you during Todd's visit last night. It was very interesting. Enjoy the evening.
Thank you, and thank you, brother, for calling. I mean that. All right, very quickly, John, thank you to my producer, John Liebert. MD PC is a forensic psychiatrist and the author of Suicidal Mass Murders, Criminological Study of Why They Kill, Hearts of Darkness, Why Kids Are Becoming Mass Murderers, and is a specialist dealing with the homicidally insane terrorist attacks that are going on. And so here he is, if I press the right button, I hope. John, doctor, welcome to the show.
Thank you.
It's good to have you. And I take it you've been following the news in your line of study all day like crazy.
Yes, I have. I have been able to follow it very closely since about noon today.
So, okay, what do you make of it so far?
It's very different than the hundreds of cases that I've been studying and following since 2008, when I first began researching and writing about the subject of suicidal rampage murders.
I don't know that this is an accurate figure, but I heard on CNN earlier today that out of the last 200 and some odd incidents of the type you just described, almost all of them were committed by single, mentally disturbed people. And so that makes this, of course, very, very rare. Is that a fair statement?
Yes, with the exception of 9/11 and the Boston bombings,
right?
Those I believe are a category unto themselves. The Fort Hood shootings, Major Hassan, and I would say that Dylan Roof down in South Carolina is a little bit off the meter too. Not sure about him, but the rest of them, for the most part, including this last guy in Colorado Springs. These people are diagnosable and more likely than not psychotic.
Mm-hmm. So generally a single crazy person. This was at least two, possibly three. I'm not up on the latest news, but I know
it's
that it's...
the latest news is two.
Two. Syed Farouk, who is dead, and Rashid Malik, I believe it is, also dead.
Correct.
And you're thinking, we talked just before you got on the air, that they're married?
That's what the police chief said in the last hearing.
Okay. There's also a story out there that they were divorced, that he was divorced from her. So I guess we'll find out ultimately what is true. But, you know, what does this to you fit? What fits when we look at what we've seen so far? Is this probably internationally inspired terrorism?
I think it's internationally inspired terrorism. Is it internationally controlled terrorism? That remains to be seen.
Either way, though, it's the same end effect, an effect, somebody going out and just killing a bunch of innocent people. So whether it's influenced or, you know, directly controlled, I kind of doubt it's directly controlled, and that's only a guess on my part. But either way, it goes back to the same sort of place. I mean, back to what's going on in Syria.
It goes back to Paris, I think. There's a woman involved in that.
Oh, could well be. Could well be. You're right. There was a woman involved in that. So
she committed suicide, too. I consider the suicidal mass murderer. These people could have easily gotten out of town. They had plenty of time. They were at the right place. I was really quite surprised that they hung around. they had to know that they were going to die.
Do you think they did know they were going to die? And do you think there's a chance?
They had to know they were going to die.
Chance they were going to try and commit another attack when they got...
I think that they planned to have another attack, but I don't think that they planned to live. I mean, I don't think that they were, you know, I don't think that they were, you know, had completed their mission. But if they really wanted to do some national damage, make a footprint nationally, you know, they hit the intersection of 215 and Highway 10, and I was expecting to read about them passing through Phoenix on our evening news. That would have been just about the right time. It's not that hard to get from that intersection to Phoenix in that amount of time.
I could have made it to where I am.
If they had gone up 215, they could have. If they had gone east on 10, they could have come where I am. I thought they selected their target based on logistics. That does not appear to be correct.
Doctor, you're an expert at this sort of thing, and the United States has a very large number of what, you know, what I call head shakers, mass murderers, where generally the person committing is going to, they know they're going to end up dead, and usually by their own hand. It's almost unique to America. It's mostly involving males, not so many females involved, so it is unusual from that point of view. Here is my question for you. I also, as an adult, have lived many years in the Philippines, where conditions are much worse economically than here. And when I say much worse, I mean people survive like on $2 a day. But they don't have mass murders, other than military action once in a while. They don't have mass murderers. And there's some cultural difference between here and there that I would love to see examined.
Is that true in the south?
Of the Philippines?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, you go down to the southern part of the Philippines, and Abu Sayyaf may well grab you and chop your head off. But what I'm, you know, that's a political, contentious, military kind of thing. What I'm talking about is people who just decide to go berserk and go out and kill as many people as they can before they are themselves killed.
Yeah. Right.
Yeah, there's not much of that going on, Doctor. And I wonder why in that, you know, it's 94 million people or more now. So it's a big sample. Why don't they have it? And we have so much of it. Any thoughts?
Well, you know, if you're looking at it from the perspective of transcultural psychiatry, comparing one society and culture to another, you know, you can dial back to the Society Islands back in the, there's a literature out of there back in the 70s during the Vietnam War when we were, again, during that period of time, we were interested in violence.
Doctor, I'm sorry, we have a very short break, two minutes. Two minutes and I'll bring you right back, so stay right there. Think about what I said and see if you have an answer. This is Midnight in the Desert.
This is Midnight in the Desert. To call the show, if you're east of midnight, call 1-952-CALL-ART. If you're west of midnight, call 1-952-225-5278.
I'm on the line with Dr. John Liebert, who is an expert on this sort of thing. That is mass murders and terrorist attacks. He's back on, and if you want to expand on why there might be this incredible difference in what's going on in America, I'd love to hear it.
Sure. Well, of course, this is, you know, theoretical. I've never thought of comparing the Philippines with the United States. However, I think that it's a valid comparison, and what you're saying could very well likely be true. I mean, well, I take your word for it. The Society Islands, when they were studied back in the days of Vietnam, another time, a period of history when we had riots on campus, Vietnam, et cetera, violence was a big issue in psychiatry, so we were studying it at that time, and now we're studying it again. But at that time, we were looking at the Society Islands. I believe it's French Polynesia now, and that was really basically before the tourist industry had moved in. It was a little bit more pure culture. And in comparing the United States society to the Society Islands at that time, there was close to zero in the way of assault, close to zero in the way of mental illness. It was... they just simply did not have the problems we're talking about.
I get it.
And the theory being that there were three factors, symmetry, intensity, and competitiveness. The Society Islands, people did not compete.
Okay, let's leave those islands for a moment and leave the Philippines as well, Doctor. Let's talk for a second about Japan. Japan is one of the most intensely, from a business perspective, it's one of the most intensely competitive countries in the world. I know Japanese very well, and they're really, really competitive. But they, too, almost never commit mass murder.
They had that very bizarre incident with the sarin gas. That was a cult.
Right.
And, of course, again, you have to...
I mean, I admit we're competitive.
This stuff gets screened out. Yeah. We have a little bit more transparency here. But, I would say that Japan is probably... I'd feel safer walking around the streets there. But you got synergy there. Japan, they're pretty, you know, except for the Korean population, which is pretty small, they're all Japanese. I think that what's the North Korean population? They have
almost entirely North Korean.
I know, but that's like 1% of the country.
You mean in terms of population factor in Japan? Very tiny.
Yeah, it's very small. Other than that, they're all Japanese and tourists. And so you've got, like the Society Islands, you've got symmetry and, you know, a synergistic population. Our population, for better or for worse, is, it's almost like a national mission today to be diverse. I mean, look what's going on in our university campuses. You can't you can't go onto the University of California campus or Harvard campus and give a lecture on turning back the clock and reducing the diversity on campus. I mean, you'd get run off the campus.
Mm-hmm.
And so, for better or for worse, our population is not synergistic. We're moving in the other direction.
So you think it's our individuality that is the culprit?
I think there are many, many factors involved. But you were comparing the Philippines to the United States from a sociological or a cultural point
right.
of view. I'm just addressing that. There are other factors in the United States, but if you're looking at it from the point of view of other nations, I mean, we're moving towards, diversity on our campuses, and it's almost like an academic mission.
You're laying out diversity as really the basic problem.
No, I don't think it's the basic problem. It's a cultural problem because you were referring to the Philippines.
Can drop the Philippines. Look, it's 94 or better, near 100 million people. They're about 90% Catholic, 86%, like that Catholic,
right.
actually. That's why I compare the Philippines, because I live there and I know it. So they just don't have these kind of mass murders, and I was just curious if you might have a thought about, they're pretty individual over there.
I do think that the analogy to the Society Islands is a factor. The asymmetry, the synergy, competitiveness, and the intensity of interpersonal relations that you have in the tropical areas that aren't too affected by modernism and tourism, they have a lower incidence of this type of behavior.
Almost zero, actually. But don't get me wrong. You can get your pocket picked. You can.
Yeah.
There's plenty of crime that goes, of that type, but not the violent crime, not the. The mass murder.
Well, that's
kind of stuff.
But there's a purpose on that. It's, it's robbery, that's very different than what we're talking about.
It is. All right. Then let me ask you this: in the 80s, President Ronald Reagan, more or less, emptied out the psychiatric hospitals.
That's a whole different issue.
Well, is it really? Why?
That's a very different issue.
Why?
Because public psychiatry, for a number of complex reasons, doesn't exist anymore. And we used to have state psychiatric institutions,
mm-hmm.
some of which were. Better than anything we have now
mm-hmm.
for the seriously mentally ill. And then we had some horrible places. But there was a movement, a store, to shut down the institutions because they were so horrible. Okay, so there were some activists, mostly psychiatrists,
mm-hmm.
just a few, and then there was John Kennedy got into office,
mm-hmm.
and had a great deal of concern and burden with his oldest sister, Rosemary, who was mentally ill and institutionalized, had a frontal lobotomy, and he was easy. He was a very soft touch for this group that wanted to close the state institutions and replace it with, a better system. And, the timing couldn't have been better or couldn't have been worse. But
listen, is that what we did? We replaced it with better?
We got rid of the state institutions,
uh-huh.
and we replaced it with a federal mental health system that really did get up and running because the President of the United States was... fully behind it for personal reasons. And the only problem is that this mental health center, mental health system, was not designed properly. It didn't do what it was supposed to do. It didn't take care of the seriously mentally ill. It became sort of, you know, a place where, you know, anybody could go and become a famous psychoanalyst and have their own little practice and that kind of thing. And it didn't do what it was supposed to do. It didn't take care of the patients who were dumped out of the state institutions. Reagan didn't close the institution so much as he did support the elimination of involuntary commitment. That's another issue.
Doctor, I'm
Wisconsin.
I'm so out of time. I've got to run, but I want to thank you for appearing on the program tonight, and we may well come back and consult you as we continue to discuss this. Thank you.
Yeah, but there is. It is true that our public psychiatric system is basically gone.
Yeah, I thank you. Thank you, Doctor. Trust me, I get that. Most of the mass murders are, well, frankly, done by very mentally ill individuals. So, there at the very last, he sort of got to the point I was trying to get to somewhat earlier. Hello in Las Vegas. You're on the air.
Art, good evening. How are you?
I'm okay. How are you?
I'm confused. I don't know what our zeitgeist is going to be this week. But I'm trying to think, wrap my head around the idea of putting things into three different columns. 9/11, the Boston Marathon bombing, the Times Square SUV, the Ford Hood, that was Islamist jihad. Then we get down to Columbine, Virginia Tech, Aurora, Sandy Hook, Oregon Community College, University of Seattle, and on and on and on.
Yeah.
All right. Now, these were white young men. And let's take the presumption that they were a Christian family of some sort or Christian belief. Third column, you have Charleston, South Carolina. You have Ferguson. You have Chicago. You have Cleveland. This is a racial issue. It's still, all of this, in a sense, is a community form of terrorism. Where San Bernardino falls into, I have no idea, because this could be merely a very emotional, upset Middle Eastern man who's very down on his luck and goes, okay, I'm going out. I want to be famous. I've been nothing all my life. I knew a lot of Saudis and some guys from Abu Dhabi when I went to college. Great guys, but tremendously emotional. Generous to a fault, but also extremely volatile. And sometimes took things the wrong way. And we're immediately ready to either draw blood or give you a bottle of scotch. It was one way or the other. Then there's something else that was, you were talking to this doctor. Do you remember way back when we had an issue in Northern Ireland with Sinn Féin?
Yes.
And this went on for 87 years and that was vicious. That was vicious, as vicious warfare or as bad a terrorism as
Fair
you would
enough.
Imagine any other yep. place on earth.
Right.
You know, Clinton brokered the deal in 94.
Right. Okay. So your point, overall point is?
My point is that if you remove any form of, let's say, he's a Christian, he's a Muslim, he's whatever, we are facing on a consistent basis to the point where we're being anesthetized with this every week, where we're seeing these kinds of atrocities.
Well, I will give you that, sir, but I'm telling you right now, this is the beginning of a new level. Something, the New York cop, I thought, made a very good point. He said the American people are going to have to get used to a level of security that they can't even imagine. And we're not going to take to it well, and I agree with him. We're not going to take to it well at all. and yet I'm not sure what the alternative is. So I'm leaving it up to all of you, just taking calls. You've seen what, you know, occurred. You probably have your own view of what's going on. And Dale's been waiting a long time on Skype. Dale, hi.
Hey, Art. How are you doing today?
Everybody asks me that. sore back a little bit, and the knee's bothering me, and, you know, my right toe, I don't know about that.
Put some of that lumen light on it.
Go ahead, sir.
So, I got a little bit different take on this than the police officer had.
Okay.
And my thinking goes back to the days of the neocons, where we thought that our best security lay in basically controlling everything.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't think that worked out well. I think what we need to do is mind our own fences, build a wall, seal the border, let people through who have acceptable documentation, and I take the other gentleman's point that that's going to be a problem, but we should start by slamming the door and then gradually letting more and more people in.
Now, I think that is probably what makes Trump so popular, taking that point of view.
Yeah.
And as these things keep happening, I think that this is like cha-ching, 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 voters going to Trump, I would think.
Yeah. Probably. And then I would purge the suspicious people who've entered from Syria and that area of the world known trouble spots for the last 2 years.
Yes, sir.
And again, be very conservative about that. And, you know, and then I don't think the police are going to be able to protect us unless we activate the National Guard and we become like any other European state with people with machine guns all over the place.
Yeah, I know.
And I don't think everybody carrying weapons would – that's not controllable. We're going to have criminals running around.
Look, we've got the Second Amendment. People are going to own weapons.
How about concealed carry? Let's encourage people to get the training.
Agreed.
And, yeah.
I agree with you 100%. You're not going to get any argument with me. If somebody knows how to handle a gun, they've got a clean record, let them carry a gun. And maybe they stop something like this. And now in San Bernardino in California, probably nearly, well, lots of cops, of course. We saw them all. But, I mean, in terms of people in that area who might have had guns, almost zero.
Yeah. So, yep. There'll be weak spots, of course. And then I don't think we need the oil out of the Middle East anymore. I would try and gradually stop invading countries there and let the Russians run things. It's their backyard. Let's let them take a lead. And I'm sure Putin would jump at that if we went over there.
He has jumped at that. He has jumped at it. But he, at the time, he said, let the Russians go bomb the hell out of ISIS, right?
Right.
The trouble is that they're not bombing ISIS.
Yeah, they're helping us to death.
That's right. Exactly right, sir. And then on top of all this, and more important even than this, awful as it is, you know, we're kind of on the edge of the possibility of a world war here.
Yeah.
Yeah.
My thought on that is like, Turkey, you shot down a Russian plane. Yeah, I know it was over your airspace. I know this. I know that. But you don't shoot down Russian planes. So, you know, staying out of World War III, that has to be the bottom line.
All right, so now we've got Russia that has brought these horrid, hardly accurate missiles in.
All right.
They hit you at Mach 5. And what happens if, I don't know, if they shoot down an American jet?
Then we say you're sorry, and we go on.
Yeah?
Yeah, I mean, we're not going to get the people.
What if it's not an accident?
Then the guys, the pilots flying that plane, would want us to not start World War III.
Yeah, I don't want to start World War III, but
so,
I'm telling you, it's in the soup over there.
Yep. Yep, you are right.
And so, what do we do here back in the homeland? Do we turn it into Israel? I've been there. It's kind of uncomfortable, actually.
Yeah. No, and that's why I don't think the police can solve it. I don't think that's the right tool. I think the right tool is becoming situationally aware, getting the training to conceal carry and more people doing that. Okay. We have to arm ourselves, as they say, because no one else here will save us.
Well, no, you're wrong. Everybody's saying it. Thank you. Everybody's saying it, right? Of my callers tonight, I would say, and I think I'm being conservative, that about 80% of them are calling for as much gun ownership as possible. I'm not necessarily against that idea. I just don't think that it's going to solve a lot. It makes you feel better, but if we have to fear going to the supermarket or going to a baseball game or a football game or just, you know, going on downtown into an area where there's a crowd, something that would attract people who want to kill for no reason, well, no reason that we in the West understand very well. How about that? Let's go on the phone to Anchorage, Alaska. Hello.
Art.
Yes.
Art Bell, timeless.
I don't know about timeless. I feel the clock ticking, sir.
No, Art. If you've lasted this long, hundreds of thousands of people you've talked to and helped, and I think you're timeless now. Real quick, before I forget, the first thing I want to do is let them know my heart goes out to those people that were innocent and got hurt, okay?
Of course, yes.
I think that sometimes we forget that. The next thing I want to say to you, Art, is that, you know, I love talk radio for a multitude of reasons. And my friends, it's hurrying home to hear your show. And they said, geez, Paul, why aren't you here to get to Art Bell? It's just a talk show. And I told them, you know, in your world it is, but in my world, when you talk to Art Bell, there's about 100 other alien races out there, and some of them are just coming out of light warp speed, and they're all reaching over to switch on the switch for the Art Bell talk show. So Art, and if they are out there, I want them to hone in on my frequency, and I want to make contact now, damn it. So, now, on the more light side, you want to get that out there, okay?
All right. Well, if you get there, sir, ask them about their culture. Ask them how it's working for them. Ask them what they're doing about this kind of problem. Or, since they probably don't have this kind of problem, ask them why they think we do. Quake, your turn on Skype.
Good evening, Art. Calling from Canada, and I just want to offer a bit of solidarity to our best neighbors down in the south there. Really sorry that this stuff is going on, and it's a damn tragedy, to be honest.
It sure is.
I just wanted to bring a little bit of history on the subject surrounding ISIS.
Yes.
There's been, like, a lot of misconception, and you've been saying a lot that, you know, they're trying to bring about the end of the world.
They are.
Like a doom cult. And that's just not factually true. It's
yes,
not what
it
they're
is.
Based around.
It is true. Right? No, sir. It's true.
Okay. What they want to do is spread Islam across the entire planet. And while us in the West, you know, we can see that as definitely it's the end of our world, they're not trying to bring about some sort of end of the book of Revelations. And I'm gonna quote directly from their hadith. I'm gonna quote directly from
Yeah, but anybody can quote from anything. The fact of the matter is, that is what they want. They have made their own interpretation that includes bringing about the end of days.
There's nothing in anything that al-Baghdadi
I know.
Said
you will not read
that
it.
States that. There's nothing in any of their literature which states that. And I don't think that that's what they're going for. I wanted to clear that they want to spread Islam as far and wide as they possibly can around the world.
Well, certainly they do have had the attitude that either you convert or you die. Right? They've had that attitude.
And they're done with the converting part because they're also killing Muslims of the Sunni faith.
I think, sir, that they have concluded that we're not going to convert. And that leaves us with the die part.
Indeed. And secondly, I wanted to point out that there's definitely going to be no Russia versus the United States or Warsaw Pact versus NATO because Putin, as despotic as he seems and as much of an iron grip as he seems to have on Russia, if you look at his popularity with the Russians, he's constantly polling at 80-90%.
Very popular.
Because they like the smart moves that he's playing.
Mm.
But they understand that if you go to war with NATO, if you go to war with the United States, Putin will be flat on his butt outside of the Kremlin in less than 12 hours. There's no way the Russian people would go along with that.
Well, it would only take one insane moment. I'm not convinced that Putin is completely sane. Are you really?
I think he's actually quite sane. He might be one of the sanest of the Western leaders right now. I mean, you don't get to survive 25-plus years in the KGB and then the FSB.
the way you survive in the KGB.
Right? And as Putin has said, once you're KGB, you're always KGB.
Oh, yeah. I believe you. And the way you survive is taking out those who disagree with you.
That's a little bit sociopathic and not psychotic. And it's the sociopaths that seem to make the best leaders, and not the psychopaths.
Okay.
The sociopaths play it like a game.
Sociopaths. They make the best leaders, huh? Well, okay.
All right. Anyways, thanks for having me on, Art. There's a whole lot to talk about, but I don't want to take on the air. Just really
no,
sorry about
leave
what
me,
happened.
Leave me with that, sir. Sociopaths make the best leaders. I'll accept that. I'll accept the fact that you said that. let's go to North Dade down south in Florida, I think. Hi.
Hello. Is this me?
Well, only you know that for sure, but it sounds like you, sir.
Okay, good. Well, it's a pleasure and honor to talk to you.
Thank you.
Listen to you for years. Okay, this is a rather interesting situation because I think that all the Muslims that were grown in North Africa and the Middle East, that Obama has set these things up, plus Soros, they spent billions there with its non-government organizations and movements, and then they set the fire, and they're pushing them up into Europe as well as Obama supporting ISIS by leaving the weapons there for them and things. A lot of things have resulted in Obama spreading Islam more than any other caliph in centuries. So they're moving up into Europe.
Well, I'm not sure it's fair to say that Obama left the weapons there knowing that they would be taken by these guys in black. How could he possibly have known that? I'm not a gigantic Obama fan, but after all, sir, this war and those weapons and that money that they got their hands on, all of that stuff, you know, that was kind of there already, and the Iraqis turned tail and ran, and that's how they got it.
Which was to be expected, and I think some of our military expected that, but there was nothing they could do. But this whole thing has resulted in tremendous stress throughout Europe and the United States. We've brought in, since 9/11, 3 million Muslims, plus he wants another million or more. And what Hama Abedin says she wants as many Syrian refugees as possible. That's Hillary's main advisor. It's all part of Hijra, which is a Muslim conquest by emigration, which is how they started Islam when they took over what's called Medina now.
Mm-hmm.
They made a peace treaty, and then halfway through they slaughtered two of the three tribes. And, you know, this is to be expected. I mean,
all right, so cutting through everything as quickly as I can, you think Obama is trying to spread Islam as best he can by his own actions. In other words, you think he's Muslim, right?
I don't know if he's Muslim or not, but by his actions, he's done these things. Either he's incredibly incompetent or he's following somebody's instructions or he's intentionally doing it. It's just that the end result is what's happened. And different decisions made since he was his first day in office would have resulted in an entirely different world.
Yeah, I can't stand behind all his decisions, that's for sure, and I don't. All right. Bottom of the hour break. So we're talking, you and I, all of us talking about what has happened today and where it's going. If you want to join in, area code 952-225-5278. National number. Outside the country, MITD 55 on Skype. Love to hear from you outside the country. We'll be right back.
Never looking back again.
This is Midnight in the Desert. To call the show, if you're east of midnight, call 1-952-CALL-ART. If you're west of midnight, call 1-952-225-5278.
Yeah, eye of the storm. Something to think about. Good evening, good morning, good afternoon, wherever in the world you are. I'm Art Bell. This is Midnight in the Desert. We're talking about what happened in San Bernardino and a lot more. Actually, we're talking about why it happened, and we're talking about what to do about it. Everybody seems pretty much in favor, well, save one guy, of gun control. So, you know, it's kind of useless to go down that road. We can, if you wish, but I'm hoping not. Hold off the false flags if you can. And back to the phones we go. Hello, Bill.
Hey, how you doing, Art?
I'm doing okay.
I'd like to tell you about how I'd like to agree with the person who spoke about how mental illness played a big part in what happened tonight.
Mm-hmm.
And
how's that? How did it?
Well, desperation. It takes a certain kind of person with a certain kind of disposition to do something like that.
Oh, that's for sure.
And it takes a certain kind of desperation, and that desperation is very prevalent in our society.
Okay, I want to back up for a second. I don't want to have it thought that I'm saying that what happened tonight was a result of mental illness. I have the feeling, sir, that what happened tonight is a result of somebody who believes in a new ideology spreading across the world very quickly now, that's coming out of its home in Syria. That's what I believe. That's what I think. I don't think it's mental illness to be committed to an idea, horrible as that idea may be.
Understood, Art. I meant that I was responding to the man that you had on, the doctor.
The doctor, yes.
Yeah, and he was kind of talking about that, and I kind of wanted to agree with him that it's a very strong, it's a very strong thing when people are desperate, especially single. You were talking about single men, and that he's kind of down on his luck, and he has marriage, and all that kind of stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, and we don't know what happened, of course, but I'm just kind of agreeing with him. That, like, I can see that the person that would have a disposition to do some crazy stuff that normally wouldn't be done, our society is kind of pushing people to be desperate, and especially men with no sort of outlet for their feelings.
All right. I thank you for the call and the comment. And please allow me to think about that a little bit. I mean, that's perhaps a general truth, but what's different here? Anybody want to try to comment on that? What's different here? There are countries all over the world where young men are desperate, generally out of work, frequently divorced, a lot of women problems, and they just don't do this. So what I'm searching for here, I guess we're having two different discussions. There is the mindless killer, generally white male, right, that we're talking about, and it is very prevalent in America. And yes, I am asking, why is it so prevalent here in America as opposed to other countries? I think, however, you know, it's my opinion that what happened today is motivated by something else entirely. But I could be wrong about that. You know, we still have yet to hear from the authorities on what motivated these people. But I think I have a pretty good idea, and I think you probably think you do too. Lexington, Kentucky, you're on the air. Hello?
Hello, R.
Yes, sir.
Lexington, North Carolina.
North Carolina. Well, see, I can't see the last part of it. Sorry about that.
That's okay. It's an honor to talk to you. I have an opinion about what to do about this. You may or may not agree, but I just like to maybe say it. I think that we need to get our heads out of our cell phones, pay attention to what's going on, what's been going on the last 2 or 3 years. These Muslim extremists has been killing Christians, beheading them all over the world.
Oh, yes.
Beheading Christians and just killing Americans, you know, in different countries, tourists, that type thing. I think we need to get with the people that are with America, the other countries, our allies, and maybe close all of our borders just temporarily, and get together and go over here and put boots to asses like we would have back, you know, in the 70s, 60s, and 70s, and just try to eradicate it because it's a disease, these Muslim extremists. That's just my opinion, and people may, everybody may not agree with that.
No, everybody may not, but that's what we're here for, to let you voice it.
Well, I sure appreciate it. But I just feel like we need to take our country back. It just don't seem like the last few presidents we've had, the last four presidents, has had our best interest at heart by sending a lot of our jobs, a whole lot of our jobs, to other countries. It seems like we've been very passive whenever it comes to these extremists that are taking advantage of the Christian people all over the world. And
well, these are slightly different subjects. If you want to talk about economics, yes, jobs have gone to other countries, but that's because, you know, it's cheaper for the companies to do that. Simply that. It's you know, I don't mix the two. You can say, yeah, there's not as many jobs here as there might have been, but is that why people are shooting up, you know, it's become the Wild West around this country? I don't think that's it.
No, sir. And I'm just saying, it just seems like the country has went in a whole different direction.
Well, that's for sure.
What I grew up in. I was born in the mid-70s, and it just, things were a whole lot different. It was very easy to get a job, you know, in those days, it seemed like, in the 70s, 80s, and even 90s. But things has just changed so much.
But something,
you know,
else
has
is going on.
To do with what happened today.
Yeah, it doesn't. But sir, again, something really basic has changed. There are plenty of societies with fewer jobs by far than we have here, and yet they don't go out and do these mass killings. So there's some other factor that we're not thinking about.
I just think the Muslim extremist is just what I hear and what I see all the time is it's the Muslims doing it. It's the Muslims doing it. Well, if it is, we need to get with our allies and stand together and just put an end to this. I mean, you know, I'm not saying drop a bomb, but, you know, just get half of each branch of each country's military together.
So would you say you're in favor of closing the borders, putting up walls, that kind of thing?
Well, temporarily, until, you know, some of this stuff, you know, until we eradicate, and we're never going to completely eradicate. There's a psycho born every day. But, I mean, you know, just try to nip this in the bud right now as it's getting started. We should have done this when 9/11 happened. And if we do that, these other countries, like one of your other callers was talking about, that hate America, mm-hmm. will set an example. You know, hey, maybe we need to chill out and not be so hard on America and quit some of this rhetoric about killing Americans and death to America, that type thing. Set an example. But it just seems like this generation of young men and women are not interested in not paying attention to what's going on around the world.
Okay. All right. I really appreciate your call. I'd say there's a psycho, he said, didn't he? There's a psycho born every day. I think there's a psycho nurtured every day. You can talk about nature and nurture, right? They're not born psycho. The environment is what creates that, I'm quite sure. Hello there outside the country.
Hello?
Hello, Steve, I think it is.
Yeah, it's me again.
All right, Steve, you've really got to get close to the microphone or I can't keep you on the air.
Okay, you got me now?
Well, you're better, yeah.
Okay. Listen, I think that a big problem is in America, you know, I've been in Germany now for 25 years. And, you know, if you're down on your luck over here, you know, you still, they pay for your rent and they help you with food. In America, you don't have all that now. So if you're desperate and everything is going bad for you, you're going crazy because America is giving their money there and sending troops there. But in our own backyard, we're suffering.
So you're essentially saying socialism is the answer. You know, if people are down on their luck, we need to feed them and house them and give them a little money.
Yeah, and give them some health insurance. There's nothing wrong with a good socialism.
Well,
there's nothing
wrong with them. Give them health insurance too. Why not?
Exactly. And with these guns, you guys need to stop the guns. Can you imagine?
Guns.
Just for example, you're
those
in a parade.
Damn guns just keep getting up on their own and shooting people randomly, don't they? It's outrageous.
Now let me finish my thought.
Finish your thought.
You're in a parade.
Yeah.
And everybody is carrying concealed guns. Now, you have a few terrorists in there. They start shooting.
Yes.
So you pull out your gun and you start shooting. And
yes.
Somebody else sees you and think you're one of the terrorists and they start shooting. And how many people are pulling out their guns and just shooting each other? It's not going to work.
Mm-hmm.
You can't.
So, in other words, we'd kill each other, you believe?
Oh, of course. That's all we're going to end up doing is shooting each other.
Okay.
Friendly fires because you thought they were the terrorists because you heard gunfire and saw somebody with a gun. You know, these.
So you think if we give them all the free stuff you talked about, that would just stop it, right?
Yeah. I don't know if it would stop it. But, we need to stop killing each other. And running around, everybody running around with guns, it's. I don't see an answer. We're not going to play the Wild Wild West.
All right, Steve. I appreciate your call. Thank you. The View from Germany. Think we can get that much free stuff out there, folks? Huh? Fast enough? Marty from somewhere out there. Hello.
Hello, it's Martin from the UK, Bristol.
Yes, Bristol. Mm-hmm.
Corey mentioned about guns earlier and restricted with what...
Okay, you're breaking up on me a little bit, Marty. Maybe you're not close enough to the mic. I'm not sure. Hello?
How's that? Is that any better?
That's a little bit better, yes, huh?
Yeah, it was just the with guns.
No, you're not. Marty, you're going to have to call me back. I'm sorry. That's all broken up. Dave, you're on the air.
Well, thanks. This is from Longview, Washington.
Yes, sir.
And hopefully I'm coming through clear.
You are.
Most of the stuff that happened today was as a result of fear. People's reaction, you could see it in the kids and the bus and the adults. But the fear was because we didn't get any information. I think that was pretty clear. That even the people reporting what was going on were saying, gee, you know, normally by now we get some information.
Well, I do agree. They withheld, CNN, for example, withheld a lot of information for a long time.
And part of that is trust of the citizens here in the United States. I mean, there's been a lot of revolution in people's thoughts and actions, and, you know, I guess our leaders have lost faith in us. We can't fix that. They're going to have to solve that one themselves because we can't all afford to do, you know, civic projects every day. But people who do get involved in civic activities are less threatened by this because they know the people who are involved and they know that, you know, the right thing will be done.
Mm-hmm.
But there's no fear in my heart because I'm not afraid of what happens next. I came here on this earth to do something. I don't know what it is, but I'm here and I'm alive now just like you are. You're filling a special niche.
I guess.
Well, I think there's got to be dignity and there's got to be a purpose.
Dignity and purpose. I do agree with that, yes.
Well, bless you and all the Roswells to you, man.
All right, thank you. Take care. You're on the air. Hello. Portland,
hello, Art.
I think. Yes.
Yeah, I'm actually driving up to Seattle right now, but anyway.
You're in a truck.
I am in a truck, yes.
Okay.
So, I've been listening to quite a few of these people that are calling tonight, and especially the guy from Germany. I had no idea that you had this many hippies calling yet. The ridiculousness that comes out of some of these people's mouths is...
Well, it's their opinion. I mean, in Germany, they do have a lot of social programs, after all. Lots and lots of them.
Yeah, and that's the thing, you know, it's like the people that say that are generally not the ones that are paying for it. the problem that I see with this entire philosophy and situation that's going on is the ideology clash. People don't seem to realize on my side, the U.S. side, I'm not in any particular religion, and I hate them all equally, to be honest with you.
Mm-hmm.
But the ideology that people are trying to change these individuals who have been force-fed this violent, hateful rhetoric since birth is never going to happen. It's hard enough to try to talk sense into a Catholic to try to see that at least there might be a possibility that there isn't a God.
Well, you know, fanatical thing that's spreading is amazing. It's amazing how quickly it's spreading, how quickly it's taking hold. How many people who were just sort of average Muslims, I guess, in life, suddenly get grabbed by this extremist point of view and convert so instantly. You've got to admit, it's fast.
See, that's the biggest thing, and what happened today is really the canary in the coal mine. And to call anyone a moderate Muslim is to not understand taqiyya. That's a word that is known throughout Islam, and everybody should check that word out tonight. T-A-Q-I-Y-Y-A. Check that out.
All right, sir. Thank you very much for the call. We're so short on time. I'm sorry. Hello there, somewhere on the phone.
Yeah.
I can't really hear you. I'm sorry. In Phoenix, you're on the air. Hello.
Hello. Can you hear me now?
I hear you.
Okay. I just think that we should do like we did to Japan and Germany when the ideology was bad. Just go bomb them with bullets, you know, bombs and bullets, take it over again. And then with the homeland here, I mean, people need to stop when they're told to stop by the policemen, and we need to obey the laws. You know, it's just as simple as that. If we just listen to what the rules are and follow them, things will be great.
All right, sir. Thank you very much for the call. All right, everybody, thank you for the show. I really didn't think, and Charles Osman, thank you, buddy. We'll reschedule you, but there was no way to not talk about this tonight, and so talk about it we did. And I'm quite sure there's going to be a very great deal of reaction. From the high desert, I'm Art Bell. Night all.